Thanks. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have built your church upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Grant us so to be joined together in unity of spirit by their teaching, that we may be made a holy temple acceptable to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated for the lessons.
A reading from the book of Jeremiah. The prophet Jeremiah spoke to the prophet Hananiah in the presence of the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, "Amen, may the Lord do so. May the Lord fulfill the words that you have prophesied and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord and all the exiles. But listen now to this word that I speak in your hearing and in the hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet, the word of the Lord. The psalm for today is from Psalm 89, which we'll read responsively by whole verse. Your love, O Lord, forever will I sing. From age to age, my mouth will proclaim your faithfulness. I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn an oath to David, my servant. Happy are the people who know the festal shout. They walk, O Lord, in the light of your presence. For you are the glory of their strength, and by your favor our might is exalted. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you were not under the law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you are entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what is the advantage did you get then from the things from which you were now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew. Jesus said, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward." The Gospel of the Lord.
You may be seated. The future of the country was hanging in the balance. Should we revolt against the foreign tyranny we despise, or should we just stomach it, submit a while longer in order to keep the peace? This was the question being debated by the prophets Hananiah and Jeremiah. The stakes were incredibly high for everyone. The future of this country was hanging in the balance. Should we revolt against the foreign tyranny we despise, or should we just stomach it, submit a while longer to keep the peace? This was the question being debated by the Whigs and the Tories. The stakes were incredibly high for everyone. What do you think God wanted? What do you believe God supported? Hananiah said that his country should revolt against King Nebuchadnezzar, and it was a popular message. Even Jeremiah admits, "Amen, may the Lord do what you have prophesied." In other words, Jeremiah shrugs and says, "Gosh, I hope you're right." And Jeremiah adds, "As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet." In other words, Jeremiah is saying, time will tell. We know that bold prophecies rarely come true quickly or easily. Thomas Lynch Jr. was 26 years old, marching to war as captain of the South Carolina 1st Regiment. He believed it was time to revolt against King George III. Thomas probably marched right down this road out here, prepared to defend Charlestown from a British invasion. Well, he never made it into battle. Young Thomas was stricken by a terrible fever and had to stop. While recovering, he was elected by the South Carolina General Assembly as a 6th delegate to the Continental Congress. Thomas also received news that his father, already a delegate in Philadelphia, had fallen ill. In April 1776, Colonel Gadsden, the commanding officer, gave Thomas permission to travel to Philadelphia. Within a few short weeks, the British fleet attacked Charlestown, and young Thomas Lynch dipped his quill into a bottle of ink and signed his name to a bold prophetic statement. He and 55 other men attested to this idea. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. What a beautiful vision for a country to have. Those words from the Declaration of Independence were a bold prophecy for the future. They were not, as we know, a matter of fact at that time. For there were so many men, women, and children living in the land who were not considered equal. Our founder's bold vision for life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness, it did not apply to the slaves who had long been at work building the foundations of an incredibly large, fertile, prosperous nation. Listen again to the words of Jeremiah. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent that prophet. Remember, bold prophecies rarely come true quickly or easily. One of my goals as a pastor, priest, teacher, and preacher is to speak the truth as well as I can understand it, even when it makes me or us uncomfortable. At the same time, my intention is not to shame people who made mistakes in the past, things done or left undone, especially if speaking such truth makes me or us somehow feel superior. My intention is to shine light on how Jesus Christ is always inviting his disciples to dig deeper and try harder to do justice and love mercy and humbly walk with God in the present. The gift of being born later in time than those who were unable to fully realize God's dream of liberty, justice, and peace for every living soul, it's that we get to envision new ways in which we might contribute to bringing about the fullness of our founder's bold prophecy. Remember Jeremiah, as for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent that prophet. In other words, time will tell. This next part of the story is harder to hear. 5 years before young Thomas Lynch signed the Declaration of Independence, he signed another piece of paper. This 21-year-old man signed a pledge to make a cash donation to this church, to our church. You see, in 1771, the vestry recognized that this congregation could not afford to pay a suitable salary for a rector. So they circulated a written request called a subscription to raise a sum of money for the purchase of a family of slaves for, quote, the perpetual use of the minister of this parish. 27 people pledged £400 sterling for this purpose. Today's equivalent would be about $110,000. One of those generous donors was Thomas. I don't have any doubt that those 27 people believed they were doing a good thing for their church. There's no doubt that the vestry believed it was doing a necessary thing if they were to have any hope of recruiting or keeping a rector. This congregation had already been in existence for 2 generations, 70 years, and it had been extremely hard. In many respects, this little church out here in the country was hanging by a thread. I remind myself every week that the legacy of our spiritual forebears here at Christ Episcopal Church is not one of slam dunk certainty. No, our legacy is one of scrappy, determined faith and hope. So I get it. I can imagine myself on that vestry back in 1771. Hey, I can hear myself saying, we've got bills to pay and they exceed our ability to pay them. So what do you do? You do what's legal. You do what's considered normal. You do what other congregations have done. As I said earlier, we have a huge advantage of being born later in time with the benefit of many years and many prophets. We can easily see now that you cannot hold as self-evident the truth that all men are created equal, and at the same time, hold as permanent property human beings for the, quote, perpetual use by other human beings, especially ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. There's another prophet I want to mention, the biblical prophet Joel. He attested to this truth spoken by God. In those days, says the Lord, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. Even on male and female slaves, I will pour out my spirit. Is Joel a true prophet? Is God really that generous? Is God really that supportive of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness by every living soul? Did that young man, Thomas Lynch, really see a vision for our country? Are we, old and young, really capable of dreaming dreams about what a beloved community can look like among the descendants of our forebears and the descendants of their slaves who still live right here in Christ Church Parish? Oh, by the way, Thomas was not the youngest signer of the Declaration of Independence. That distinction belonged to another young man born just 3 months after Thomas. His name? Edward Rutledge, who was also from Christ Church Parish. Now, how about that, y'all? half of the signers from South Carolina of the bold prophecy of life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness for every person, both of those young people came from our parish. In the light of the declaration we celebrate on July 4th, in the light of the declaration signed by two young visionaries from Christ Church, what is the Holy Spirit saying to us now? Well, I have a dream. I dream of this congregation doing more than just figuring out how to pay its bills. Despite my own obvious interest in us paying a suitable salary for the rector, I still have a dream, and it involves doing more than what is considered normal for a parish to do. It involves being more gracious than what is legally expected of former slave owners to be. I dream of us connecting the bold vision of the biblical prophets with the beautiful vision of those Philadelphia prophets and with our own true story. I dream of us reclaiming those hard-to-hear words for perpetual use, reclaiming those words for goodness sake. I dream of a 21st century subscription list to create a perpetual Christ Church Liberty Fund for scholarships that benefit children within our parish boundaries who are the descendants of slaves. I dream of volunteers from among you helping to circulate that vision to people beyond our congregation. There are many donors out there willing to be generous with a perpetual fund that allows real people with real needs the chance of an education to further their pursuit of happiness. I want to put our feet on the courageous pathway of Thomas Lynch and Edward Rutledge, young visionaries from our parish who pledged themselves to the bold prophetic idea that everyone deserves a shot at life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness. What if we start with a goal of the 1771 subscription amount, $110,000. See, in a perpetual fund, that's already a $5,000 a year scholarship forever. Sadly, Thomas Lynch did not get to see his vision even partially realized. He and his young wife died at sea just a few short years after he signed his name to the bold prophecy that we celebrate this Tuesday. And we know Jeremiah was right. Bold prophecies rarely come true quickly or easily. Yet the good news, it lies right before us in this historic place. We have an opportunity to help this vision become even more fully realized. Jesus makes two wonderful promises in today's gospel lesson. He says, "Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward." And second, Jesus says, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Our Heavenly Father, the source of light and life, who is calling us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Standing together, let us affirm what we believe in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us continue standing as we offer our prayers, being particularly mindful this Sunday, closest to our nation's celebration of independence, of our gratitude for this freedom and the duties it imposes upon us.
Oh, beautiful for space the skies, forever waves of grain.
Almighty God, giver of all good things, we thank you for the natural majesty and beauty of this land. They restore us, though we often destroy them.
Heal us.
We thank you for the great resources of this nation. They make us rich, though we often exploit them.
Forgive us.
Oh, beautiful for heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved, and mercy won. Amen. self-control, thy liberty is gone.
We thank you for the men and women who have made this country strong. They are models for us, though we often fall short of them.
Inspire us.
We thank you for the torch of liberty which has been lit in this land. It has drawn people from every nation, though we have often hidden from its light.
Enlighten us.
Oh, beautiful for-painted dream that peace beyond the years. Thy alabaster cities gleam, undimmed by human tears. America, America, much that is great on thee. And from thy good with brotherhood, from sea to shining sea.
We thank you for the faith we have inherited in all its rich variety. It sustains our life, though we have been faithless again and again.
Renew us.
Help us, O Lord, to finish the good work here begun. Strengthen our efforts to blot out ignorance and prejudice, and to abolish poverty and crime. And hasten the day when all our people, with many voices in one united chorus, will glorify your holy name.
Amen. Let us also offer our prayers for the church and for the world beyond our national borders.
We pray for all bishops, including Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Ruth, our bishop, and for this parish and its leaders, and for all ministers and people. Let us pray for peace in the world, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. Let us pray for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and for all who are weary and carrying heavy burdens.
We pray for healing for Dale Barnett, Cy Prokaski, Eva Goodall, Mike McCusker, Chuck Kimball, Shelby Pickard, Ben Ekman, Parker Linder, Robin Oakman, and Harry Fendridge, and for others whom we remember and name at this time.
Let us pray for those who have died.
We pray for the repose of the soul of Emily Ann Payne, in whose memory the altar flowers are given today, and for others whom we remember and name at this time. O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Peace. You may be seated. Good morning and welcome. I am glad that you have chosen to worship with us today here at Christ Episcopal Church. I want to say a special thank you to our diocesan seminarian, Eric Bash, who is serving in an internship with several of the diocesan parishes this summer. And I had the benefit of attending the clergy retreat at the beginning of summer with the clergy, and Eric was there, was seated near him at the time of worship, and heard his voice and said, "Eric, I don't know what else you might do to help us this summer, but I definitely want you to sing." And so thank you. And then thank you, Lord, to hear a congregation come together. And I believe I heard even some harmony today. That is always a beautiful thing. I also would like to thank Jan Bolger and Liz Goodman, who covered the office for Kim and me on Thursday when we went out of town to visit family. I'm grateful for that gift of time away. Speaking of singing, that's really the only announcement today. I want to make sure you know there's no pressure in this, right? We don't come here to be pressured. But if you would like to sing, and the hymn number is in the bulletin, like, say, the offertory hymn or the communion hymn, you're invited to join in. You can remain seated. We don't need to stand. I know you're passing a sweetgrass basket around. I certainly don't want that to, you know, be interfered with. But you're invited to sing along with the choir at any of the times you see the numbers listed there in your bulletin. Are there any celebrating birthdays or anniversaries this week who would like to receive a blessing? If so, come forward at this time. Seeing none. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, for you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace. Alleluia.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Standing together, let us offer our concluding Thanksgiving prayer. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which surpasses all our understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks.